Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Gildan Audio presents an unabridged recording of Computing, A Concise History by Paul E. Ceruzzi, narrated by Timothy Andres Pabon. Introduction. A familiar version of Zeno's paradox states that it is impossible for a runner to finish a race. First he must traverse one half of the distance to the finish, which takes a finite time, then he must traverse one half of the remaining distance, which takes a shorter but also finite time, and so on. To reach the finish line would thus require an infinite number of finite times, and so the race can never be won. The history of computing, likewise, can never be written. New developments transform the field while one is writing, thus rendering obsolete any attempt to construct a coherent narrative. A decade ago, historical narratives focused on computer hardware and software, with an emphasis on the IBM Corporation and its rivals, including Microsoft. That no longer seems so significant, although these topics remain important. 5 years ago, narratives focused on the Internet, especially in combination with the World Wide Web and online databases. Standalone computers were important, but the network and its effects were the primary topics of interest. That has changed once again to an emphasis on a distributed network of handheld devices, linked to a cloud of large databases, video, audio, satellite-based positioning systems, and more. In the United States, the portable devices are called smartphones, the name coming from the devices from which they descended. But making phone calls seems to be the least interesting thing they do. The emphasis on IBM, Microsoft, and Netscape has given way to narratives that place Google and Apple at the center. Narratives are compelled to mention Facebook and Twitter at least once in every paragraph. Meanwhile, the older technologies, including mainframe computers, continue to hum along in the background, and the hardware on which all of this takes place continues to rely on a device, the microprocessor, invented in the early 1970s. Mathematicians have refuted Zeno's paradox. This narrative will also attempt to refute Zeno's paradox, as it tells the story of the invention and subsequent development of digital technologies. It is impossible to guess what the next phase of computing will be, but it is likely that whatever it is, it will manifest four major threads that run through the story. The digital paradigm. The first of these four major threads is a digital paradigm, the notion of coding information, computation, and control in binary form, that is, a number system that uses only two symbols, 1 and 0, instead of the more familiar decimal system that human beings with their 10 fingers have used for millennia. It's not just the use of binary arithmetic, but also the use of binary logic to control machinery and encode instructions for devices, and of binary codes to transmit information. This insight may be traced at least as far back as George Boole, who described laws of logic in 1854, or before that, to Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz, who lived between 1646 and 1716. The history that follows discusses the often cited observation that digital methods of calculation prevailed over the analog method. In fact, both terms came into use only in the 1930s, and they never were that distinct in that formative period. The distinction is valid and is worth a detailed look, not only at its origins, but also how that distinction has evolved. Convergence. A second thread is the notion that computing represents a convergence of many different streams of techniques, devices, and machines, each coming from its own separate historical avenue of development. The most recent example of this convergence is found in the smartphone, a merging of many technologies: telephone, radio, television, phonograph, camera, teletype, computer, and a few more. The computer in turn represents a convergence of other technologies, devices that calculate, store information, and embody a degree of automatic control. the result held together by the common glue of the digital paradigm, yields far more than the sum of the individual parts. This explains why such devices prevail so rapidly once they pass a certain technical threshold. For example, why digital cameras almost overnight around 2005 drove chemical-based film cameras into a small niche. Solid-state electronics. The third has been hinted at in relation to the second. This history has been driven by a steady advance of underlying electronics technology. That advance has been going on since the beginning of the 20th century. It accelerated dramatically with the advent of solid-state electronics after 1960. The shorthand description of the phenomenon is Moore's Law, an empirical observation made in 1965 by Gordon Moore, a chemist working in what later became known as Silicon Valley in California. Moore observed that the storage capacity of computer memory chips was increasing at a steady rate, doubling every 18 months. It has held steady over the following decades. Moore was describing only one type of electrical circuit, but variants of the law are found throughout this field, in the increase in processing speeds of a computer, the capacity of communication lines, memory capacities of disks, and so forth. He was making an empirical observation. The law may not continue, but as long as it does, it raises interesting questions for historians. Is it an example of technological determinism, that technological advances drive history? The cornucopia of digital devices that prevails in the world today suggests it is. The concept that technology drives history is anathema to historians, who argue that innovation also works the other way around. Social and political forces drive inventions, which in turn shape society. The historical record suggests that both are correct, a paradox as puzzling as Zeno's, but even harder to disentangle. The human-machine interface. The final thread of this narrative concerns the way human beings interact with digital devices. The current jargon calls this the user interface. It goes to the philosophical roots of computing, and is one reason that the subject is so fascinating. Are we trying to create a mechanical replacement for a human being, or a tool that works in symbiosis with humans, an extension of the human's mental faculties? These debates, once found only among science fiction writers, are not going away and will only increase as computers become more capable, especially as they acquire an ability to converse in natural language. This theme is a broad one. It ranges from philosophical implications about humanity to detailed questions about machine design. How does one design a device that humans can use effectively that takes advantage of our motor skills, such as using a mouse or touchscreen, and our ability to sense patterns, such as icons, while providing us with information that we're not good at retaining, such as Google or Wikipedia? We shall hear that these detailed questions of human use were first studied intensively during World War II, when the problem of building devices to compute and intercept the paths of enemy aircraft became urgent. With those four themes in mind, digitization, convergence, solid-state electronics, and the human interface, what follows is a summary of the development of the digital information age. Chapter 1. The Digital Age. In the spring of 1942, as World War II was raging, the U.S. National Defense Research Committee convened a meeting of scientists and engineers to consider devices to aim and fire anti-aircraft guns. The Blitzkrieg, a brilliant military tactic based on rapid attacks by German dive bombers, made the matter urgent. The committee examined a number of designs, which they noticed fell into two broad categories. One, directed aircraft fire by constructing a mechanical or electrical analog of the mathematical equations of fire control, for example, by machining a camshaft whose profile followed an equation of motion. The other solved the equations numerically, as with an ordinary calculating machine, only with fast electrical pulses instead of mechanical counters. One member of the committee, Bell Telephone Laboratories mathematician George Stibitz felt that the term pulse was not quite right. He suggested another term that he felt was more descriptive, digital. The word referred to the method of counting on one's fingers or digits. It has since become the adjective that defines social, economic, and political life in the 21st century. It took more than just the coining of a term to create the digital age, but that age does have its origins in secret projects initiated or conducted during World War II. Most histories of computing which purport to cover the full range of the topic don't explain how such an invention, intended as a high-speed replacement for calculators during the war, could have led to such a far-reaching social impact. Nor do these wartime developments, as significant as they were, explain the adoption of digital techniques for communications. That took place not during World War II, but two decades later, when an agency of the U.S. Defense Department initiated a program to interconnect defense computers across the United States. That combination of computing and communications unleashed a flood of social change in the midst of which we currently live. Telecommunications, like computing, has a long and well-documented history, beginning with the Morse and Wheatstone electric telegraphs of the 19th century, followed by the invention and spread of the telephone by Alexander Graham Bell, Elisha Gray, Thomas Edison, and others later that century. What was different about the 1960s computer networks? Nearly every social and business phenomenon we associate with the Internet was anticipated by similar uses of the telegraph a century earlier. The telegraph combined with the undersea cable did transform society, yet the transformation affected by the more recent application of a digital paradigm seems to be many times greater. It's dangerous to apply modern terms to events of the past, but one may violate this rule briefly to note that the electric telegraph, as refined by Samuel Morse in the 1840s, was a proto-digital device. It used pulses, not continuous current, and it employed a code that allowed it to send messages rapidly and accurately over long distances with a minimum number of wires or apparatus. Typesetters have long known that certain letters, such as E, T, A, were used more frequently than others, and on that basis, the codes chosen for those letters were shorter than the others. A century later, mathematicians placed this ad hoc understanding of telecommunications on a theoretical basis. What came to be called information theory emerged at the same time as, and independent of, the first digital computers in the 1930s and 1940s. Binary base 2 arithmetic, bits and bytes, 8-bit coded characters, are familiar at least in name to modern users of digital devices. The roots of that theory are less well known, but those roots made the modern digital age possible. Many historians of computing begin with Charles Babbage, the Englishman who tried and failed to build an analytical engine in the mid-19th century, the same time as Morse was developing the telegraph. The reason is that Babbage's design, what we now call the architecture of his machine, was remarkably modern. It embodied the basic elements that were finally realized in the computers built during World War II. We now see, however, that to begin with Babbage is to make certain assumptions. What exactly is a computer? And what is its relation to the digital age that we're living in today? The components of computing. Computing represents a convergence of operations that has been mechanized to varying degrees in the past. Mechanical aids to calculation are found in antiquity, when cultures developed aids to counting and figuring, such as pebbles. Latin, calculi, from which comes the term calculate, counting boards, from which comes the modern term countertop, and the abacus, all of which survive into this century. Although it may seem arbitrary, the true mechanization of calculation began when inventors devised ways not only to record numbers, but to add them, in particular, to automatically carry a digit from one column to the next when necessary, especially for carries like 999 plus 1. That began with Pascal's adding machine of 1642, or with a device invented by Wilhelm Schickhard in 1623, Leibniz extended Pascal's invention by developing a machine a few decades later that could multiply as well as add. The mechanisms by which these devices operated lay dormant until the 19th century, when advancing commerce and business created a demand that commercial manufacturers sought to fill. Toward the end of that century, mechanical calculators of intricate design appeared in Europe and in the United States. The felt comptometer, invented in the 1880s, was one of the first successful calculators, owing to its simplicity, speed, and reliable operation. The Burroughs adding machine, invented by William S. Burroughs around the same time, also was a commercial success. Burroughs survived as a supplier of electronic computers into the 1980s and is the ancestor of today's Unisys. In Europe, machines supplied by companies including Brunswick and Odner were also widely sold. On these machines, the user set numbers on a set of wheels rather than press keys, but they worked on similar principles. As significant as calculation were two additional functions: the automatic storage and retrieval of information in coded form, and the automatic execution of a sequence of operations. That's the reason historians began with the analytical engine that Charles Babbage attempted to build in the 19th century. Babbage never completed that machine, for reasons that only in part had to do with the state of mechanical engineering at the time. In the 1830s, when Babbage was sketching out ideas for an engine, neither he nor anyone else could draw on electrical technology to implement his ideas. Everything had to be done mechanically. Given the necessary level of complexity that a computer must have, a mechanical computer of decent power wasn't practical then, and not today either. The recent successful reconstruction, at great expense, of Babbage's other project, the Difference Engine, proves this point. It works, but the Difference Engine's capabilities are nowhere near those of the analytical engine. An analogy might be to compare Babbage's vision with Leonardo's sketches for a flying machine. Leonardo's vision was sound, but heavier-than-air flight had to await the invention of the gasoline engine to provide sufficient power in a lightweight package. By this measure, one might begin the history of computing in the late 19th century, when the American inventor Hermann Hollerith developed, for the 1890 U.S. Census, a method of storing information coded as holes punched into cards. Hollerith developed not just the punched card, but a suite of machines that used cards to sort, retrieve, count, and perform simple calculations on data punched onto cards. The devices he developed combined complex mechanisms with electromagnets and motors to perform operations. The use of electricity wasn't required. A rival inventor, James Powers, produced pure mechanical punched card equipment to avoid infringing on Hollerith's patents. But in practice, the flexibility that Hollerith's use of electricity gave his machines was an advantage, as the machinery was called on to perform ever more complex operations. By the time of World War II, electrical circuits took on an even greater significance, not just as carriers of information, but also as a way of performing computing operations at high speeds, a property that in theory is not required of a true computer, but in practice is paramount. The inherent flexibility of Hollerith's system of machines built around the punched card led to many applications beyond that of the U.S. Census. Hollerith founded the Tabulating Machine Company to market his inventions. It was later combined with other companies to form the Computing Tabulating Records Company, CTR, and in 1924, the new head of CTR, Thomas Watson, changed the name to the International Business Machines Corporation, today's IBM. In 1927, the Remington Rand Corporation acquired the rival Powers Accounting Machine Company, and these two would dominate business accounting for the next four decades. It's not known where Hollerith got the idea of storing information in the form of holes punched onto cardstock, but the concept was not original with him. Babbage proposed using punched cards to control his analytical engine, an idea he borrowed from the looms invented by the Frenchman Joseph-Marie Jacquard, who lived between 1752 and 1834, who in the 19th century used punched cards to control the weaving of cloth by selectively lifting threads according to a predetermined pattern. Jacquard cloth is still woven to this day. Jacquard looms were common in Hollerith's day, so he was probably familiar with the way punched cards controlled them. However, there's a crucial difference between Jacquard's and Hollerith's systems. Jacquard used cards for control, whereas Hollerith used them for storage of data. Eventually, IBM's punched card installations would also use the cards for control. It's fundamental to the digital paradigm that information stored in digital form can be used for storage, control, or calculation. But an understanding of that would not come until decades later. Before World War II, the control function of a punched card installation was carried out by people. They carried decks of cards from one device to another, setting switches or plugging wires on the devices to perform specific calculations and then collecting the results. The concept of automatic control, the ancestor of what we now call software, is a third component of computing, and it too has a history that can be traced back to antiquity. Jacquard's invention was an inside-out version of a device that had been used to control machinery for centuries, a cylinder on which were mounted pegs which tripped levers as it rotated. These had been used in medieval clocks that executed complex movements at the sounding of each hour. They are also found in wind-up toys, including music boxes. Babbage's analytical engine was to contain a number of such cylinders to carry more detailed sequences of operations as directed by the punched cards. Today, we might call this the computer's microprogramming, or read-only memory, ROM. Continuous control of many machines, including classic automobile engines, is affected by cams, which direct the movement of other parts of the machine in a precisely determined way. Unlike cylinders or camshafts, punched cards can be stacked in an arbitrarily long sequence. It's also easy to substitute a short sequence of cards in the stack to tailor the machine for a specific problem. But Jacquard looms used cards that were tied to one another, making any modification to the control difficult. Control, storage, calculation, the use of electrical or electronic circuits. These attributes, when combined, make a computer. To them, we add one more. Communication. The transfer of coded information by electrical or electronic means across geographical distances. This fifth attribute was lacking in the early electronic computers built in the 1930s and 1940s. It was the Defense Department's Advanced Research Projects Agency, ARPA's mission, beginning in the 1960s, to reorient the digital computer to be a device that was inherently networked, for which communication was as important to it as calculation, storage, or control. The origins of the electric telegraph and telephone are well known, but their relationship to computing is complex. In 1876, Alexander Graham Bell publicly demonstrated a telephone, a device that transmitted the human voice over wires. The telephone's relationship to the invention of the computer was indirect. Computers today operate by electrical circuits that allow only one of two states. In modern terms, they are both digital, as described, and binary. They count in base 2.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.